Bakker, the naturopath from New Zealand, where it's winter time and we're cold, and you're all hot there in the Northern Hemisphere. Let's talk about parasites, one of my favourite topics. Not the best thing to talk about at parties, though, I discovered. Right? Especially as the evening goes on, it's not really good. But anyway, we're not at a party, we're talking to you now, and let's talk about parasites. Dientamoeba, fragilis, blastocystis, hominis. What are the differences? Well, let's look at blastocystis, for example. It's very common. In fact, now with air travel being so cheap, it's probably the most common, one of the most common parasites, really, in the Western world today. Up to 23% of people in the USA have got blasto. So why the hominis part? Well, in several years ago, probably about 25, 30 years ago, it was discovered really that this particular protozoan, a single-celled eukaryocyte, you know, cell, a parasitic cell, which likes to feed off organic matter, this particular one was found a lot in humans, so they call it hominis because they thought it was a human parasite. But the hominis, unfortunately, Blastocystis hominis, they've also discovered a similar type of a blasto in, you know, the intestines since then of snakes, you know, amphibians, rats, gorillas, like all sorts of creatures also can have blasto. In fact, there's 12 or 14 RNA variants. So there are many different types of strains on of Blastocystis. And this is what makes it challenging really to try and kill it. But I can tell you guys now from the research I've conducted and working with patients for so long with blasto, blasto does become a big problem in some people, but in other people, they can't really work out why it's not causing a problem because it doesn't seem to cause a disease. If you want to get technical, there was a guy called Koch, K-O-C-H, who first postulated a theory years ago that bugs could become a real problem if they infected somebody, you know, like a parasite, for example, or a bacteria, if it got into somebody and actually caused a disease. That's called Koch's postulate. But with blasto, that theory doesn't really work out because some people who get blasto don't get sick at all. Other people who get blasto mildly get very, very sick. What they also discovered, it affects people most who are immunocompromised. In fact, I think I read a report where they looked at 11 of the world's best infectious specialists, conducted many different trials and studies, and wrote extensive research papers on blasto, all regarding immunocompromised people. So if you've got a bad immune system, it's not a good idea, for example, to travel widely, and especially to handle pets and animals. You need to be much more careful, you know, with hand washing, which is the main transmission of Blastocystis. It's the oral fecal route. So you need to really be careful with hand washing. If you're not immunocompromised and have got a good immune system, blasto will not affect you anywhere near as bad than if you've got it. There's a high chance you may have a blasto, for example, if you've got irritable bowel syndrome and you can't shake it. This is one of the main reasons I like people to have stool testing, is to look for the diamond among the coal, okay, if you know what I'm talking about. The coal and the diamond, okay, you've got to look through a lot of coal before you find the diamond, all right? Now, sometimes you've got to go through a lot of doctors and do a lot of tests before you find what's wrong within there. And sometimes a stool test, you'll actually find the diamond, okay, the blasto. Well, in your case, it's not a diamond. It's more, you know, something you don't really want to own, but you know what I'm saying? I mean, you'll actually locate what you've got and where it is. Dientamoeba fragilis. Note the word fragilis on the end. Fragile. Doesn't often last long outside of the body. Dies very quickly. It's the crybaby. It's the crybaby, okay? I find Dientamoeba much easier to get rid of than blasto. It's also linked with irritable bowel syndrome. It's not nowhere near as common or as prevalent. It tends to be more prevalent in the more affluent communities, you know, people with more money for some reason, and also affects younger people more than all age groups, particularly people under about 7 or 8 tend to be more prone to Dientamoeba than older people. But I have seen it in adults. I find nearly every time when I treat a person with both, the Dientamoeba will disappear within 4 to 6 weeks, but the blasto stays behind. Okay, the more experienced guy, he'll stay there. So what do you do? Well, stool testing is going to really show you what you've got. How do these guys compare? Well, they're very similar to each other. Blasto tends to be a little bit more endemic and cosmopolitan, meaning it tends to be around more. It's harder to shift. Dientamoeba is a very similar organism. It's much easier to eradicate. That's in my professional experience anyway. Don't fear them both. There's an easy solution, okay? Learn to live with it and improve your health and gut in general, and you'll often find that as time goes by, you won't really experience so much of the discomfort that you had in the earlier years when you have Dientamoeba or Blasto. But check out my other videos and be sure to download my free report in the description box below. There's a nice shopping list there which could really help you if you've got parasites. Hey, thanks for tuning in. I also appreciate the viewers. Thank you.